Well, good morning, everybody. I'd like to thank Shay and Jens and everybody here at Seattle Science Foundation for the opportunity to come and address you this morning. I'm going to talk about something I've been working on for the past 20 years, which is sort of the development of a robotic system for spinal surgery. And by way of disclosure, obviously we've got Professor Dubisset sitting here in the front, who really, through his papers, has taught us all really a lot about how we do things. The question is now, at this point going forward, you know, is it time to rethink the way we're doing things? When you look at technology and neurosurgery and orthopedics, there's a tremendous amount of development that has been going on. And the majority of that development really has been in the field of image guidance and utilizing imaging and marrying that to the patient to give us an intraoperative view of what we're doing. When we look back at technology, we have a rich history in medicine and neurosurgery and orthopedics. This is Walter Dandy, the first one to use an endoscope in the brain. Bovie, obviously, where would we be without William Bovie and the usage of the Bovie electrocautery device? Rod Iskewian would be in a lot of trouble. We've got Greenwood with the usage of the bipolar. The operating microscope has come into use, obviously, in the 1960s. And then really came image guidance, and this is Roberts from Dartmouth, utilizing how do we take an image from a patient, and this started off in the brain, obviously, and marry that image to the patient so that we could, in three dimensions. And this became very important in neurosurgery because we needed to know where we were at any given time when we're operating deep within the brain. Watanabe first used the first sort of handheld device, the wand as it was called, to be able to precisely identify location in the brain in real time. That changed the field of neurosurgery forever. That utilization of that same type of stereotactic technology has moved into the field of radiation now. So we've got stereotactic radio surgery for the brain and for the spine, for that matter. This is John Adler from Stanford and the CyberKnife. There's not a brain operation now in this country or pretty much in the developed world that is done without image guidance. Utilizing in real time that ability to find out where we are in the brain has really changed what we do. We've had it in spine surgery as well. This is about 10 years ago when we was utilizing intraoperative image guidance to do percutaneous screw fixation in a young man who sustained a trauma. And what I realized at that time was that we're doing the same things. As you saw in that last picture, everybody's looking away. Nobody's looking at the patient. We're all looking at the screen. So our focus now, especially in a percutaneous approach, isn't looking at the anatomy, but it's looking at that screen. And there's a leap of faith that needs to happen when we stop looking at the patient and start looking at a screen, because sometimes things aren't perfect. So why would we use image guidance? Why is that something that we're even, you know, considering? Well, we want two things. We want to increase our accuracy, and we want to increase our precision over time. And the reality is that we're pretty good right now, but we may not be as good as we think we are. When we look at data going back to Gertz, Bynum, and Robbins, utilizing the ability to sort of grade how we are, so a report card, as it were, of how we do with placing instrumentation, we do pretty good, but we're not perfect. When you look at large meta-analyses of screw placement, we realize that, you know, we're pretty good about 90% of the time without navigation. And then with navigation, that level of perfection or preciseness increases to about 95%. And this has been borne out now in large meta-analyses of screws. We look at thousands and thousands of screws placed, and this is it right here. Conventional accuracy, that is freehand placement, about 68% accurate. Now, the good news is that the majority of a misplaced screws aren't necessarily hazardous to the patient, so a small breach here or there is tolerable. But when you start using 2D fluoroscopy and then 3D navigation, it goes up 84% to 95%. And these are thousands of screws. And the reality is that the question is, you know, is OK good enough? Oh, and no sound.
Stated. Well, not officially. Nervous?
Yeah.
Yeah, me too.
So, So the question is, you know, is this okay? Because what's not okay, obviously, is our complications. And, you know, every day we pray that this doesn't happen. But the reality is that this, when this does happen, it can be catastrophic. When you look at the adoption of image guidance, we realize that in the spine, we've been a little bit behind. So in the brain, 100% of all brain tumor cases now are utilizing image guidance in real time. But when you look at the spine, up to 2013, it was about 15%. And the reason for that is that the surgeons who were practicing felt that it slowed them down. It was an impediment to their workflow, and the reality was that why would you do something that's going to slow you down? The counter-argument being, why would you do something that's going to make you more accurate? And this is where the conundrum occurs. So when I look at my colleagues in brain surgery, we're sort of the guys carrying the compact 64 on our shoulder. All my brain colleagues who are utilizing image guidance and these advanced technologies, they're the iPhone guys. We have now, we're at a nexus now in medicine and surgery. So we've got developments, and Professor Dubisset shows some beautiful advancements in imaging. We've got advancements in surgical techniques, and now we've got this advent of robotics. So imaging and surgery, image-guided surgery, that has been around for a while. Surgery and robotics with Da Vinci and other robotic platforms are coming out. And now we have this opportunity now to meld those three things together, bring those three together. When you think about robots in medicine, this is sort of what everybody's, you know, thought. When you see this in the movies and when you talk to people, what's going on? This woman's entering into this chamber where this robotic operation is going to deliver an alien. We're not quite there yet. So you've got advanced imaging. Tumors identified, maybe a little bit of local anesthetic, perfect incision coming up here, a little betadine, always good, and there you have it. This automation in surgery, though, the concept has been around for a long time. This goes back, you know, 30, 40 years plus. In Russia in the 1980s, the ability to do surgery in an assembly line fashion to take care of cataracts and other problems really sort of revolutionized this. We've got master surgeon who would sit at one seat, and then the patient would rotate a next patient, and be able to do this. It seems like science fiction, but that was 30 years ago. When you look at the advent of robots now, you realize that these are coming into our lives in every single way possible. When you think about what the first five jobs that robots are going to take, middle management, thankfully, all our hospital administrators, gone. Salespeople, again, it's still daunting when I walk into a Target and I walk into the self-checkout line in Target. I feel like I'm going to shoplift here. I'm looking to have to check my own stuff out, but salespeople. Report writers and journalists, a lot of that technical writing is now relegated to advanced artificial intelligence. Accountants and bookkeepers, as long as they keep me out of jail, it can be a robot, I don't care. And then ultimately doctors. And I said, well, how are we going to be replaced? When you think of the cognitive burden for an oncologist, for example, how can an oncologist now keep up with the medical literature? So through things like Watson from IBM, we've got the ability now to assimilate tremendous amounts of data. If you're a 35-year-old woman with a certain type of breast cancer and you live in Baltimore, this chemotherapy is better than if you live in Philadelphia. We're going to get to that level, and the reality is that that is happening through advanced artificial intelligence as we speak. The first surgical robot came out in the 1980s. Looks very nice. She's smiling here. She's having a hole drilled in her head by somebody that's not scrubbed in. But the ability to target precisely a location has been around for a while. This was the first commercially available robot. RoboDoc was used to core the femur. And then the first robot in spine surgery, I actually got to be a part of. This was in Phoenix. This was Curtis Dickman, who was my partner at the time. We were doing a lot of thoracoscopic surgery for disc herniations, anterior releases, and whatnot. And as a resident, my job was for 8 hours to stand there holding the endoscope while Dr. Dickman would do the transthoracic operation through a small incision. So the good news is, once this robot came, it actually held the endoscope for him. So I was the first casualty of robotics and spine surgery, and I'll say I was very happy that I did not have to hold the endoscope for another 8 hours after that. Probably the biggest success story is the robot everybody's familiar with, which is the Da Vinci robot. And the Da Vinci robot obviously is a master slave robot born out of the military's need actually to do surgery remotely. So how can we have a patient in theater somewhere and we operate from afar? And now obviously the surgeon sits 5 feet away from the patient, but the surgeon could be sitting 2,000 miles away from the patient. Spine surgery, this is the Mazor, which is the first sort of foray into this. Rosa, we've got other robots now that have been coming out that do everything. We've got robots in orthopedics that do knee surgery. We've got an endoscopic robot now for bronchoscopy. And in spine surgery, people are saying, well, where's it going to fit in? Well, it's going to fit into things that we do every day in a routine basis. And placing instrumentation really is sort of the place that it would start. And I don't think, you know, don't think of the robot as an autonomous device that's doing something completely on its own. But really, the term is more of a cobot. And that's something that functions with the surgeon. And in analyses of workflow, the reality is that when you have it works side by side. So people in a factory and industry who work side by side robots, their efficiency increases tremendously. And it gives the surgeon a little bit more downtime. And this is Dr. Askewian. When you talk about automating this accuracy, though, this is what we're dealing with. So this slide here is a robot that's programmed to throw a dart. And look in the lower left-hand corner. If you're playing against this robot at a pub in Ireland, you're going to lose every single time. Every throw of that arm is a perfect bullseye. That's what we want in spinal surgery. We want to be able to place hardware reproducibly in a situation where we can do this on a daily basis. So what are the goals really for robotic surgery? We want patients, you know, we're looking at patients who want less invasive surgery, obviously. We want to reduce our radiation exposure. So we just saw Jens Chapman beautifully place screws in the iliac spine, shooting multiple x-rays. Over the course of our lifetime, we get exposed to a tremendous amount of radiation. And the reality is, you know, we should be able to cut that down. We want to be able to make our procedures more consistent. And then we also would like to plan. So we started this about 20 years ago with the idea of being able to target the pedicle in real time utilizing a robot. This is Neil Crawford, my co-inventor of the Excelsius robot. And the reality is that, you know, it sounds easy. And I told Neil, it's just a math problem, isn't it? And the fact of the matter is that, you know, having motion control and being able to build a device that will take you to a definable location in a reproducible fashion over time does take some work. This was our first iteration of our robot. And the reality was that, you know, you wanted to take the best part of the brain operation, which was having real-time image guidance. So you want to know where you are at any given time. You want that robot to be able to follow you, and you want to be able to mimic the actions and targeting that you do. This is our first percutaneous real-time pedicle screw placement. And, you know, we think we got it finally. And this is, again, if you look at the first site, it's 2000, this is 2012. And finally, in 2017, got FDA approval. And now you see that there are, you know, several commercially available robots out in the sales place. Considerations, obviously, from our perspective, from a surgeon's perspective, is how does this work? How does it fit into your workflow? Does it attach to the table? Is it on wheels? So there are a whole bunch of considerations that come into play here. And then, of course, the other issue is having real-time image guidance. If you're taking a tumor out, if I'm doing a tumor, if I'm doing some sort of infection, if there's some sort of issue where you need to have that guidance of where you are in space, obviously having the robotic aspect married to image guidance becomes critical. The second consideration, obviously, from surgeons, because everything has to do with workflow. As I told you, the reason that that image guidance wasn't adopted was because the early workflow was way too cumbersome. And surgeons who learned to do things open in freehand did not want to take a step backwards. So this has to be able to fit into your workflow. So the having the robot come in, not displace a resident or displace your surgical staff, but come in as a cobot, truly as an assistant in surgery is the goal of this technology. when you talk about the design considerations, imaging is crucial because we live and die by that. And the paradigm now exists that where we can put pedicle screws in based on two x-rays, AP and lateral fluoro. And you would target the pedicle as you would draw with your finger on a screen, and I'll show you during the demonstration exactly where you want that pedicle screw to go. You can do it with two x-rays. You can do it with preoperative CT. A lot of these deformity patients will have a preoperative CT. In surgery, then we'll get an AP and lateral x-ray, be able to merge that to the preoperative CT, and then navigate in real time utilizing robotics. Or you can use an intraoperative cone beam CT, such as the O-arm. Part of the problem when you're doing any sort of percutaneous surgery is you need to have some sort of feedback. So there are a couple things that you worry about, and we always worry about with image guidance, especially in percutaneous situations, about being off, registration being off. So in addition to that reference array that you see, there's an additional surveillance marker, and that additional marker gives you real-time feedback of fidelity of how accurate you are at any given time. Because again, to be able to do this in a routine basis requires that you have that feedback. So that becomes a real important part. And the second thing is, not only do you want to know if something moves, if the patient moves, if the tracker moves, et cetera, because if it does move and you have one tracker, you don't know that. And that's where problems can happen, and that's where complications can occur. And the second issue is having active force feedback. If you're drilling and the drill skives, you need to know that. So you'll have feedback in real time about deflection of the tip of the drill. So the reality is that it's all these things come together. So this is the first case that we did at Johns Hopkins in 2017. What you see is about 60 people in the operating room. Dean of the medical school is there. Everybody's watching, and I push the button and I tell the robot to go to L4, and it goes to L5. And I look around, I say, okay. My fellow's like, what's wrong? Sweat's beating down on my forehead. And I say again, go to L4, it goes to L5. And I said, she goes, what's wrong? I said, if this doesn't work, I said, I'm gonna be in the surgeon relocation program. I'm gonna be in Panama for the rest of my career because I've just spent 20 years of my life working on this. Turns out, robot's perfect. Our incision was off because we did it open in the first case. Little sigh of relief there. The dean was looking at me going, is everything okay? Everything's fine. Of course it is. So how does this work? So it's pretty easy. I'll show you in the demonstration. But you're able now to take the reconstruction of the patient, whether it's CT, intraop fluoro, intraop CT, or whatever, and literally drag and drop your screws to where you want them to go. So the nice thing is you can avoid the adjacent facet. What I'm finding now is I'm putting in much larger screws because I'm going right down the axis of where I need to be. So normally you would say, give me a 5.5/45. Now I'm saying give me a 7.5/50 because I'm able to plan that trajectory. Once you plan that, the robot wheels in. Nice thing is that it's on wheels, so we're using it in one room. Put the screws in, wheeling it to the second room. Here's the setup here. You've got the robot at the head, not really comes into the surgical field. And then comes the screw placement. The nice thing, especially for minimally invasive cases, once everything is planned, push a button, robot goes to the trajectory, I drop a marking pen through so I know where the entry points are, make the incision based on those entry points, and then I'm able to navigate and place screws at that point. So once those incisions are open, make a little finger dissection. And then what you're seeing is you're watching in real time. You're watching the drill go down the pedicle, and nothing's being taken away from you as a surgeon. You're feeling that power drill go down the pedicle. You're feeling that screw go in, but the nice thing is you're also seeing that in real time. When you're doing things open, we have that tactile and visual feedback. When you're doing something percutaneously or less invasively or open, because you can do it in any paradigm, you want some sort of feedback. So as the arm is rigid, the arm withstands about 180 pounds of force, the reality is that when you put that screw in, you feel that screw is going through the bone. So that will take you, and you're watching it in real time as it does your trajectory. Just a couple of quick cases. This is a 90-year-old woman who has this L5-S1 sort of dehiscence. She basically had multiple sort of onlay fusions. Again, doing this open with x-ray is sort of difficult. Image guidance it wouldn't be so difficult, but so this is something that can be fixed percutaneously with large screws. This is another unstable burst fracture in a guy who with ankylosing spondylitis, BMI of 50, not really something that's excites you, but the reality is this is something now that can be done in about an hour percutaneously placing screws. This is our one of our fine citizens of Baltimore. We're probably the largest IV drug use population, and see a ton of epidural abscesses and osteomyelitis. This girl comes in with the chief complaint of a bump in her back. But again, utilizing this technology to help us place screws. Another sort of chin on chest deformity, another infection. Again, utilizing this to help us. And this, utilizing the robot to help place the screws is one thing. Having the real-time image-guided feedback when you're doing the T1 osteotomy and doing your correction is obviously very beneficial as well. And this is the post-operative result. And then, we've got patients who have very small pedicles. And these are challenging. I don't care who you are. I struggle with this and have. But the reality is that, when you can target things perfectly, you can really, this can definitely up your game. And it can help you, be a little bit more accurate in what we do. It also gives us a chance to think about how we're doing things. So one of the things that we are thinking about, obviously, are transvertebral screws, different trajectories, which you couldn't normally hit. Jens, when he just showed us the S2AI screws, that's easy. I mean, that takes 30 seconds. No x-ray, no fluoro exposure to you. Once you plan that on an imaging study, those screws get placed. This now, I think, gives us a new opportunity to look at accuracy and how we define accuracy in what we do. So now I've got the ability to have a plan and then look at what happens after surgery and merge those two. So how did I affect that plan? So before, with Gertz, Bryan, and Robbins, am I in the pedicle? Okay, I'm good. But now, how good am I to the plan and how did I affect that plan? So we published on this now, and I'm not gonna lie to you, there's some things where things don't line up perfectly. Nothing's dangerous, nothing's bad. You wouldn't give this a second thought, but the reality is that we sort of hone in on what the paradigm is, it makes us better in everything that we do. Early series now coming out have shown again that utilizing the advent of a robot, increases your accuracy over that of image guidance. So once again, it's an incremental increase, but there's a definite advantage to utilizing this type of technology. And again, odds ratio of 95% for perfect accuracy, confidence levels. Again, this data is now starting to come out and being published throughout. We've got several papers in press and already coming out showing the early accuracy. So what does that mean? So we're putting pedicle screws a little more accurately. But when you step back and think about this for a second, I was just talking about this with David Skaggs, when you look at our colleagues in orthopedics, there's been a knee robot available for years. Mako has got a beautiful robot to help jig knee. Master knee surgeons say, I don't need a robot. Why do I need a robot? Well, the fact of the matter is now at 5 years and 6 years experience, what they're finding out is that there's much less mechanical failure, much less pain, and better fit of those joints that are done with the robot. Because as good as you are, as good as we all are, as good as we think we are, the reality is we can probably do a little bit better. And the fact of the matter is now that's coming out, I would argue that in spine surgery, we avoid the adjacent facet, can put in longer and bigger hardware, we may have less failure there. There's a lot of things that we can do from a planning perspective. So just recently we led our last 28 cases of utilizing MIS for single level or two level pedicle screw fixation, match them to controls. And this is what we showed. Again, there's a learning curve to everything. We started off and it was 3 hours, 3.5 hours, 4 hours. And I was thinking to myself, well, I can do this open in 3 hours or 2 hours. But what we saw was a 4.5 to 5 minute decrease per case over that time, to the point now where we've got the MIS TLIF reliably down to 2 hours. And the fact of the matter is that people who do this every day can do that for sure. In a teaching institution, when I have junior and mid-level residents now being able to do this, that's a differentiator. And that, I think, that's sort of part of where I'm going right now. And the fact is that there's a learning curve to everything. So you adopting robotics, do not expect the first day to be doing everything in 10 minutes. There is a little bit of a practice effect. And if you look at the literature, and this is really based on Da Vinci and their early experiences, somewhere between 10 and 80 cases. I would argue for spine robots, somewhere about between 10 and 15 cases, till you get the workflow down for what works for you. Nobody's trying to teach you to do something differently, but the reality is it does take a little bit of different thought. What does that mean for our surgeons? So I think that one of the interesting things is that the millennials, a different breed, a different type of surgeon, different way of learning, and a different, we've got shorter work hours right now. they are embracing this technology. We don't have as much time with them as we had. This just came out from the New York Times about a week ago. Your surgeon's childhood hobbies may affect your health. And it was talking to surgeons throughout the country, master surgeons, and they said, you know what? This new generation of younger surgeons, they just don't have the same ability to work with their hands as we did. And is it because that, you know, as kids we were building models and now texting, and interestingly enough, I thought to myself, well, if you can text as fast as my son can, you must be a master surgeon. Turns out that the texting truly does not translate into manual dexterity. So the fact of the matter is that we are at a deficit there, and I think that this type of technology is going to bridge that gap where we're going to be able to take the next generation of surgeons and help them, you know, get ready to operate on me. There's always costs associated with all technology, and the reality is that this has been looked at, you know, time and time again, and I think we need to do a better job. This just came out last week, safeguards for robotic surgery, and of course everybody tries to lump everything together. This is related to the Da Vinci robot that they're now using for mastectomies. The breast is right there. Do we really need a robot? I don't know, but the reality is that this is out there right now. A couple of early cost studies have showed that, you know, the ability to decrease our cost comes for several things. We can collapse the time of the procedure. If I can get now these MIS TLIF patients out of the hospital the next day, we're saving money. And of course, decreasing complications, misplaced screws and things like that, decreasing litigation, decreasing takebacks, et cetera. So ultimately, I think that, you know, there are a few things that prevent the adoption of technology. And a couple of those things are cost and whatnot, but the driver really is going to be our ability to do what we do in a safer and more reliable fashion. And I think the future really has to do with this sort of compilation of utilizing these technologies for each different pathology, whether it's intraoperative imaging, pre-op imaging, robotics, et cetera, image guidance, being able to bring all those to bear. When we look at what we're doing now, this is sort of the beginning. Posterior lumbar instrumentation for degenerative disease. Trauma, obviously we can expand into that easily. Sacropelvic fixation, we're now doing S2 AI screws in 2 minutes with the robot, and then expanding our portfolio into deformity, et cetera, and then ultimately sort of, you know, coming out this whole panoply of everything that we do utilizing advanced technology. I think ultimately the in conclusion, I'll say that this, I think we're on the cusp of cutting edge technology now. Our field is changing. I think we need to certainly do a better job of the technical aspect, but also thinking of, about what we're doing and being able to plan appropriately. There's not a one-size-fits pathology or one-size-fit approach for everything, and we're going to obviously continue to collect data in this regard. So with that, I'd like to thank everybody for your time and attention this morning.
Questions for Nick Theodore.
It's interesting. So I consult for a group purchasing organization called Health Trust, which is a very large GPO. The GPO is an entity that oversees purchases for hospital systems. And actually, Health Trust is the largest purchaser currently within the different GPOs that exist in the country. I think there are about six. They have about 1,500 hospitals. Largest purchasers of robots. In fact, your robot is online with them, and we're meeting next Tuesday to look at the benefits and cost analysis to move forward with a robot and one specific robot. It's interesting if you look at the cost effectiveness of using robotics potentially in the spine. Can you comment on, is it really using a robot to place an implant? Because it seems that so much of spine surgery, the currency has become the pedicle screw. It's become an implant, which is really, in my mind, putting the cart before the horse, because a screw, a hook, this is a fixation point, right?
Right.
But could you then use that robot to disrupt, change the supply chain and purchasing and distribution factors to demonstrate the cost utility of it? Can you comment on that?
Well, I don't have an MBA, but the reality is I think that, you know, the when you put it into that mix, the question becomes, from an economic standpoint, What's the driver from each individual surgeon for each individual hospital? So the surgeons are asking for this, who have adopted earlier, who have found a decrease in their time and workflow, et cetera. That translates into stuff, into a cost savings. When it comes down to the implant, I think that ultimately, if you think about it, once you, you'd imagine the price of everything comes down, right, over time. So utilizing this type of technology probably is going to drive the cost down, I would imagine, of implants.
It's interesting because you look at the first thing that robots or robotics will theoretically reduce is the middleman, right?
Right.
Middle management. If you could plan out every surgery and you could have on-time shipping for it, and your shipping goes from $12.50 a pound to 57 cents a pound, and if the carrying cost of a company for their implants becomes essentially zero because their inventory in the field is essentially zero because they're using on-time shipping, you wonder if that would actually drive down and demonstrate cost efficacy for this technology rather than placement of a screw. Because the hospital, it doesn't matter to them if the screw's medial. It doesn't matter if the screw's lateral.
Sure.
It doesn't matter if the amplitude for stim is 40 milliamps as opposed to 20 milliamps.
Right.
It doesn't matter. But you wonder, and there's such a race to the bottom of the screws, I mean, how much can you peel off? Or could the cost really come off in terms of when the screw comes off the lathe, the process for which the screw goes into the patient?
I think there's definite room for improvement on the supply chain. There's no doubt about that. And I think that, you know, you would be able to have that case planned. So my cases are all pre-op CT. They're all pre-planned. So I know exactly the implants I'm going to use. The problem is if somebody drops a screw or something happens, you're going to have a little bit of wiggle room there. But to your point, you could peel pack and ship out that, you know, have the instruments flashed, and then have the implants come in a plastic bag the day before.
Because SPT goes away as well.
Right. So I think that's brilliant. I mean, and I'm sure that that's going to be, in the big picture, that's going to be the way it's going to go. I agree. Yeah.
And, can you comment on planning using the software that you have for that from a CT versus an MRI scan?
So so CT MRI merge has been around for a long time. It's not quite robust enough to be able to plan on a pre-op MRI screws yet, at least in this paradigm. Yeah. I think it's coming. Right. Because you can merge CT, you can merge plain X-ray to MRI pretty reliably. That, you know, as far as the workflow for that being commonplace, whereas you wouldn't need to get a pre-op CT, I think that's going to come. Yeah. That's you know, my guys at Hopkins and biomedical engineering are working on that right now. That's definitely a possibility. You can get two X-rays or three X-rays and potentially merge to an MRI. Not quite there yet, but that's the future too. And that's, I think, what's going to, you know, hopefully disrupt this entire, you know, the radiation aspect. This solves one problem because I'm not getting irradiated anymore at all. But it doesn't solve the other problem, which is the patient necessarily getting ready if you get a pre-op CT.
Right, you guys get that question in terms of if you look at then the ability to sync the robotics. Currently, the algorithm requires a CT scan, and there's pushback from the insurance standpoint, as well as cost efficacy.
Yeah, or plain X-ray.
From CT. Use it on plain X-ray.
No CT. You can navigate off a plain AP and lateral X-ray, too. So you don't need a CT.
But in line then with that same then thought process is obviously everybody gets an MRI scan, but from my understanding, some of the algorithms that are being used currently, they would require such fine cuts on the MR that then it would take 3 hours to get MR instead of 45 minutes, which,
yeah,
again,
no,
it just depends on the technology. And so rather than layering in a CT and MR, which then eats at the bottom line for the cost efficacy of this technology, could it be an MRI scan? Because patients get an MRI scan anyway. So
I think that's coming. That's a great point, Shay.
Really awesome work. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Really, really cool.
Appreciate
great
it.
Great talk.